greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The latest COVID-19 surge from worsening. The Philippine government vowing to use the full extent of the law on quarantine violators. Hey, health experts see the Philippines' latest coronavirus wave peaking at around 20 to 40,000 daily cases by mid-January. And we'll discuss the Philippines' long road to economic recovery post-pandemic with Philippine Competition Commission Chairman Arsenio Balisacan. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Hey, thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Topping the midday news, Metro Manila looking to impose mobility restrictions on the unvaccinated in light of the latest COVID-19 surge in the Philippines. Metropolitan Manila Development Authority Chairman Benher Abalos says mayors have agreed to pass local ordinances that will bar unvaccinated people from making non-essential trips.
Para kang nag-ECQ only for the unvaccinated, no? For their own protection. Dapat nasa bahay lang sila, pwede sila lumabas kung bibili na sila ng essential goods and services.
Abalos says this policy will only take effect while Metro Manila is under the stricter alert level 3. He adds, mayors are still finalizing the restrictions.
There is an urgent need for the Metro Manila local governments to enact the respective on the enhanced restrictions on vaccinations to regulate the mobility of the unvaccinated individuals in the NCR. Ito'y inaayos lamang namin subject to form and style. Kaya lamang namin ito'y nilalabas ngayon, no? Para lamang may announce kaagad at mapaghandaan ng bawat isa.
the city of Manila has already reimposed its curfew on minors. Metro Manila will remain under alert level 3 until January 15th. The new planned restrictions come after the Philippines recorded its highest daily COVID-19 tally in over 2 months. It logged 4,600 new infections Sunday. The positivity rate was at 19.6%. That's way above the 5% recommended rate by the World Health Organization. And that still doesn't include data from 9 labs, which failed to submit testing results. The Okta Research Group believes the country will continue to see a rise in infections in the coming days, with numbers possibly surpassing past surges due to the Omicron variant.
Titingin ng kung kayo po ay nag-positive o negative. So, importante po talaga makontrol po natin yung mga borders natin.
Ang danger is dahil napakabilis niya, pag makalusod siya sa mga ibang provinces, mabilis silang spin kakalat doon sa provinces na yun, especially areas na hindi pa ganun katas yung vaccination.
There may still be more adjustments to Alert Level 3 currently in place in Metro Manila. Acting Presidential Spokesperson Carlo Nograles says the COVID-19 Interagency Task Force will revisit the rules when it meets Tuesday. This time, it will take into account the progress in the country's vaccination drive.
When these rules were crafted and announced, that was a time na mababa pa yung vaccination natin. During that time, hindi pa natin nababakunahan yung below 18. But right now, things are different. Right now, we are allowing now that we are giving vaccination now to 12 to 18, remember. And then marami na sa mga senior citizens natin ang bakunado na. And mataas ang vaccination rate ng NCR. Let's wait for the announcement ng IATF.
The Philippine government vowing to get tough on quarantine violators. This after a Filipino traveler from the U.S. was able to skip her isolation to go to a party. The traveler, later identified as Gwyneth Chua, tested positive for COVID and infected at least 15 others. An investigation into the incident is underway.
Because of what happened, then we will... Number one, we will ensure that whatever applicable laws that can be enforced, we will enforce. Whatever can be prosecuted and who can be prosecuted, we will prosecute. No, and it's not just, you know, civil cases to be filed, but talagang criminal charges will be filed against those responsible, whether it's the violator or the establishment. We will do what is necessary to serve as an example also to all.
Those who are found in violation of COVID-19 health protocols can be fined up to 50,000 pesos or face imprisonment of up to 6 months. Face-to-face classes in Metro Manila suspended as the National Capital Region reverts to Alert Level 3. Our correspondent Ara Perez now joins us on the line for details. Ara, what else can you tell us? By the way, Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year, Carmina. That's right. According to DepEd, face-to-face classes in NCR have been suspended as the region remains under alert level 3. This is in accordance to IATF guidelines. In-person classes will proceed in areas under alert levels 1 and 2. DepEd is finalizing its report and recommendation on the pilot study of face-to-face classes, which ended this December. Earlier, DepEd said it plans to implement this January the expansion phase or adding more schools that will reopen for physical classes, but assured this will still be based on the risk assessment of areas. For face-to-face classes in colleges and universities, CHED said 30% capacity is allowed in areas under alert level 3 and 50% capacity for areas under alert level 2. Starting December, limited face-to-face classes for all degree programs have been allowed in higher education institutions in alert levels 1 and 2 areas, and January for areas in alert level 3. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Ara Perez there joining us on the line. Back here in the newsroom, two hospitals in the city of Manila temporarily limit admissions amid the surge in COVID-19 cases. The Justice Jose Abad Santos General Hospital exceeded its COVID bed capacity. On New Year's Day, many of its personnel also contracted the disease. The hospital says it has to decongest first and address the increasing number of coronavirus cases before it can resume accepting more patients. It adds intensive cleaning and disinfection will be done to prevent the further spread of the virus. The Gat Andres Memorial Medical Center faces a similar dilemma due to the number of employees stricken with COVID.
No, we're a little bit scared. Ang bilis din ng pagdami, no? From yung zero, yung karamihan sa mga ospital, yung bago ho magpasko, bigla hong nagkaroon ng pasyente, umabot ng 9, pagkatapos 29, 39.
Hindi pa po napupuno yung mga hospitals natin. Pero kung patuloy po ito natataas, definitely po mararanasan natin ulit yung mga naranasan natin dati.
The ICU utilization rate in the entire Philippines is currently at 22% and 27% in Metro Manila. Despite only 14 Omicron cases confirmed so far, the country's COVID-19 treatment chief believes the Philippines is already in the midst of an Omicron wave. Health Undersecretary Leopoldo Vega notes the country's resources only allow government to sequence less than 2% of all positive samples. He believes Omicron could become the dominant variant within a month.
Since we reported our first Omicron case way back December 5, and there has been a continuously increase in the sequencing of this Omicron virus, it looks like we will presume that the Omicron is here, but it's still not dominant. I think in about 3 to 4 weeks, as predicted, the Omicron will be dominant in terms of 50% to 90% of the cases overtaking the Delta virus. But the Delta virus definitely is still around with us. It exists toe-in-toe with the Omicron virus right now.
Meanwhile, COVID-19 infections in the Philippines could reach a peak of 20 to 40,000 cases. That's according to Professor Jomar Rabahante from the University of the Philippines' pandemic response team. Rabahante adds the peak could come as early as January 15, but the timeline is still dependent on various factors.
Yung timeline na yan ay depende sa magiging behavior natin, no? Kasi kung talagang kahit may alert level 3 tayo pero yung implementations ay hindi masyadong maganda at still people will be very mobile, mas bibilis yung transmission ng Omicron. So mapapaaga ngayon yung peak natin. Yung delay naman ng peak ay if there will be good indication na naging effective yung mga alert levels natin and people will somehow maintain yung minimum public health standards, pwedeng madelay yung peak.
The city of Baguio shuts its borders to tourists amid an ongoing spike in COVID-19 cases. It stopped accepting leisure travel requests on January 2nd. The suspension will be in place until further notice. But those with pre-approved travels prior to January 2nd will still be allowed to enter the city. The new restriction comes after active cases in Baguio rose to 64 on New Year's Day from only 4 on Christmas. Well, for 2 years now, governments around the world have been forced into a tough juggling act dealing with this pandemic while keeping economies afloat. And it seems countries will be facing that same challenge, at least for the early part of 2022, due to the Omicron variant. For discussion on this and the long road ahead to recovery, we're now joined by economist Arsenio Balisacan. He is, of course, chairman of the Philippine Competition Commission. Chairman, Happy New Year to you, and thank you for joining us today.
Happy New Year, Carmina, and good afternoon to everyone, to you and to our listeners.
So let's begin our discussion by your description of the current state of the economy as we enter the new year, Chairman.
Well, for the year 2022, we expect the economy to improve a bit compared to the situation last year. As has been mentioned by peers, colleagues, and of course our government, the economy is likely to have grown 5 to 6% last year, 2021, and we expect that momentum to continue. Of course, given the contraction in 2020, sharp contraction in 2020, and the sharp losses of opportunities, particularly employment, it would want to have that the growth this year to be faster than what we had last year.
But Chairman, you've seen the rise in COVID numbers just in less than a week. How much of a game changer or how much of an impact will the Omicron variant have on the recovery efforts?
We expect that we have learned our lessons in the past 2 years, as many of the other countries did. And so as even as cases have risen and given the what we know now about this Omicron and the other likely variants, we should be able to manage those cases better than last year, especially as these are particularly the Omicron is likely to be less serious or to cause severe cases than what we had with earlier variants. So our hospitals, our healthcare system must have improved compared to the situation in 2020. Obviously, we have done, we could have done much better, and we should attempt to do much better and take advantage of any lockdowns or slowdowns in mobility so that we can catch up in our healthcare systems.
Yeah, and how much of a catching up do you think must happen? Because even if the symptoms are mild to moderate, even if we have that vaccination rate, the kind of vaccination rate that we have at least here in Metro Manila, the protocols remain the same. People are going to have to isolate themselves. And the more people and the high transmissibility of the Omicron variant means that a lot of people may just be isolating themselves. And this could lead to an unintended, really slowdown, even shutdown of the economy. What are your thoughts regarding that, Professor?
Of course, the science there is still evolving, but what we do know now and what we read is that the virus is less severe and it appears to cause less health problems compared to the earlier variants. Obviously, of course, the magnitude of the cases will be a concern. But again, just like flu, we can have a lot of those flu, but as long as those do not overwhelm our health system, we should be okay and we should be able to get our economy moving. Of course, it will be at slower pace than otherwise would be the case, but it should not be as paralyzing as what we had in 2020.
All right. A while ago, you mentioned that hopefully we have learned the lessons from the past 2 years. And you kind of go into this in a recent paper that you co-wrote entitled When a Pandemic Strikes, Balancing Health and Economy Towards Sustainable and Inclusive Recovery. I want to get into some of the details in that paper, Professor. I want to ask you now, as we look back on the year that was, and this is, you kind of touched on this as you wrote your paper, what can you tell us about the role that governance and policy making had in exacerbating the impact of the pandemic on the economy?
All right. I think that, again, one lesson that we have learned, not only here in the Philippines, but in many countries, is that governments, when they respond to crisis like this, should make use the best science possible around there, because obviously this is not the first time that countries have had pandemics, and we have learned from many from lessons of pandemics in the past. This is a very different pandemic, we know, but I think we should have exploited the available expertise and science there so that we would have better managed the economy part of the of the health crisis, or of the crisis, even as we are addressing the, you know, the health issue. I think what has happened is that we get the economy suffered so much, and as a result, the economy in 2020 contracted the most, one of the sharpest contractions in the world that we have seen, obviously. We ask ourselves what could have we done better, and I think that is a lesson that we can take fully as we move forward.
Are you confident now, Chairman, that these lessons have been learned and these are the lessons that will be implemented, especially as we enter a new wave of COVID infections due to the Omicron variant?
I think I do. I do think that we are seriously taking stock of those lessons and employing them. What we notice that the way we respond to the crisis now has evolved, and it's encouraging that we have listened, or our government has listened, for example, to what the private sector has also been saying and what the science community is saying. And I think that conversation is healthy and it should be encouraged. And as we move forward, again, I would like to see that that conversation even more intense and expansive so that we can move forward with the crisis.
I want to talk about the inequalities. There were many, Chairman Balisakan, and there were many even before the pandemic struck. Tell us now about the inequalities that were exaggerated due to the pandemic and also the new inequalities that were created because of the pandemic.
Yes, I think what we should note is first is that the inequality in our country has been high even before the pandemic, higher than many other countries at similar stages of development. And it's so, and when this health crisis is struck us, that inequality was exacerbated because those who have less in life have less access to health services. Those who are poor, unskilled, low education, don't have the same opportunity for work from home arrangements, and so on and so forth. They don't have access to the internet, these new ways of doing things under new normal. So that created or exacerbated the inequality. The creation of new ones has something to do with the digital economy. Shift to a digital economy or digitalization occurred faster than what we had expected because of this pandemic, and obviously many of our people, particularly the unskilled, the poor, the uneducated, those living in rural areas and with low access to infrastructure, internet infrastructure, would not be able to take advantage of those ways of moving forward under the new normal.
So what must be done, Chairman Balisakan? What must be done to bridge that gap?
First, for example, is I think that we can't stop anymore this digitalization. I think we need to ride along with that. It's going to move fast, and we need to get our infrastructure development in telecom, for example, move faster. And there are many reforms that we need to do to get that going. For example, in the telecom and in the logistics infrastructure, we need to hasten the passage, for example, of the Public Service Act so that we can take advantage of private capital, particularly foreign capital to come in and use whatever limited resources of government has for addressing the health sector and education sector and as well as for providing assistance to the poor, to the MSMEs, for those in the high contact centers. So that's one. The other one is that in responding to the crisis, we must not do some quick fixes that hurt our economy in the medium to long term. One of these, for example, is the tendency to relax enforcement of antitrust or what you call competition policy, where obviously many small, medium enterprises had financial difficulties and they become very vulnerable to acquisitions by dominant players in the market. And if that happens, the economy even becomes more concentrated and it becomes more subject to market power that that can potentially lead to higher prices, mm-hmm. lower innovation, and so on. So in many other countries, during the crisis, they did not do that. They did not relax mergers and acquisition rules, for example, so that they're able to protect the medium to long term. Mm-hmm. And because obviously, as what I said, the inequality, the rise in inequality that has occurred, investment that did not take place, the debt that have accumulated, particularly among smaller medium enterprises, the institutional capital, the linkages that were broken and disappeared, especially among businesses. Those are what I called scars, economic scars that will have impact in the future.
Yeah, so I guess, I'm sorry to cut you there, Chairman. So I guess the question now is, having presented to us the picture that you just presented, I guess it goes without saying that we've been really hit hard by this pandemic. I guess the question now left to be answered is, will the wounds be superficial or will the scars left be so deep and long-lasting?
The scars now, as they happened in the past 2 years, are really quite deep already. As our estimates of poverty, for example, show that we have added, because of the crisis and our response to the crisis, easily another 8 to 9 million people are poor, and many would have nutrition, their nutrition, their health adversely impacted as a result of lower incomes or lack of employment. Mm-hmm. This would have a longer term impact on the human capital of our country. And as you know, what brings about sustainable growth over the long haul is the rise in productivity, and that comes from this human capital. And if we don't if that human capital is eroded because of things like this, the education is not being given to the children who become members of the labor force in the future, we would not expect high productivity from these children when they join the labor force. So things like that, and those are the ones that should be that policy should ensure that the scar there would be as low as possible. And,
yeah. And we're not even talking about the other issues that were affecting the country even before the pandemic hit. You got to talk about climate change, food insecurity. You mentioned poverty incidents a while ago. How will this now complicate our efforts to recover from the pandemic?
Well, I think it's we need to revisit our approach to public policy, Carmina. For example, we do know that government resources are very scarce. That revenues, government revenues, are not coming in huge amounts, and that's expected in the near term. But we do know that the private sector is also awash with the pandemic with cash. So, for example, I think that a lot of the public infrastructure project, particularly those in urban areas, could be undertaken by the private sector. We need to get the public-private transfer, that the partnership program going, and then get our resources, limited resources, used to address the problems, for example, in the social sector, the health and education. I think we can do a lot of re-engineering our responses such that even with limited resources, we can achieve much.
We do know that the private sector has been very, very helpful throughout this pandemic, but it was largely because of their own initiative. What about coming from the government, really institutionalizing this kind of public-private partnership to be geared towards the recovery of the country post-pandemic?
Yes, I think, as I said, there's much that can be done with the public-private partnership. Infrastructure is one, and I'd like to note that we have gained so much experience in that and lessons in making public-private partnership work. There are obviously a lot to fix, but we can make it work for us. Then again, government resources are not so are very limited, and we need to do proper targeting of and the use of those resources. For example, I don't think that there is any objection to the proposal that limited subsidies assistance should be given to those who deserve most the subsidies, the poor and those MDs, los jóvenes, not to everybody. Why would people living in high enclave places get the same subsidy as the rest of the poor who don't even have a shelter to cover their head? Things like that. I mean, there's much that we can do to improve the way we can use our resources. And the government is, I believe, and as I see it, is doing its best to respond to that in a way that it can achieve the objective.
Well, finally, Chairman Balisakan, I'm talking to you now not just as an economist, but also as chairperson of the Philippine Competition Commission. What role do you think will competition play in our recovery efforts, in the road to recovery? And I'm also going to have to ask you, how might cartels hinder the recovery efforts post-pandemic?
That's a good question, Carmina. Competition policy is a means to enhance the ability of markets to deliver economic welfare. It would be in the form of lowering prices, improving the quality of goods and services, as well as promoting innovation. No? Of course, cartels would achieve that opposite thing, which is, you know, to raise prices, reduce the quality of the services, and so on. We have seen is that when you don't have a robust competition policy, cartels can proliferate. Cartels can take advantage of the fact that they can exercise their market power, not knowing they're not going to be penalized for it. Again, taking the lessons of the past 2 years, insofar as the responses of many jurisdictions to the crisis, what we do see is that jurisdictions, including us, would want to ensure that these cartels do not and abuses of dominance by market players will not be there to derail the recovery process and to ensure that the recovery will be inclusive and sustainable.
Well, we wish you all the best. Arsenio Balisakan there, Chairman of the Philippine Competition Commission. Happy New Year to you. And here's wishing that this year will be better. I believe it's going to be better. Do you believe it's going to be better this year?
Of course, I believe, Carmina. And thank you so much for the opportunity to share views with you and our listeners.
Always a pleasure talking to you. Happy New Year, sir. Take care and keep safe. We're going to take a break now. Up ahead, Israel expands its rollout of a fourth COVID-19 dose to health workers and the elderly. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC.
Hello, Washi! Laundry Day.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Philippines, here's another look at our headlines this noon. The unvaccinated facing mobility restrictions as Metro Manila tries to prevent the latest COVID-19 surge from worsening. The Philippine government vowing to use the full extent of the law on quarantine violators. And a health expert sees the Philippines' latest coronavirus wave peaking at around 20 to 40,000 daily cases by mid-January. Back with more news, the United States setting new records as the pandemic enters its third year. The U.S. broke the single-day case count several times last week. The weekly increase in cases also registered a new pandemic high, with over 2 million new infections added to the tally. Based on the latest count by Johns Hopkins University, the U.S. has now breached 55 million cases and 826,000 deaths. America's top infectious disease expert says there is still a danger of a surge in hospitalization, even as early data suggests the Omicron variant is less severe.
You've got to be careful about that, because even if you have a less of a percentage of severity,
When you have multi-fold more people getting infected, the net amount is you're still going to get a lot of people that are going to be needing hospitalization. And that's the reason why we're concerned about stressing and straining the hospital system.
France becomes the sixth country in the world to report more than 10 million COVID-19 infections. More in this report.
France has now become the sixth country in the world to report more than 10 million COVID-19 infections since the pandemic began, according to official data published on Saturday. This news comes as health authorities in the country confirmed more than 200,000 daily COVID cases for a fourth straight day. France joins the United States, India, Brazil, Britain, and Russia in having had more than 10 million cases. French President Emmanuel Macron warned the next few weeks would be difficult, but during his New Year's Eve address did not mention a need for more restrictive health measures, adding that the government should refrain from further limiting individual freedoms. Meanwhile, the government said earlier on Saturday that from Monday, wearing masks in public spaces would be mandatory for children as young as six. And some big cities, including Paris and Lyon, have reimposed the wearing of masks in the street for everyone.
Israel expands its rollout of fourth COVID-19 shots to anyone over 60 and health workers amid an Omicron-fueled surge. The country already began administering the second booster dose to people with weakened immune systems last week. This comes as daily cases in Israel are expected to reach record highs in the next 3 weeks.
Israel started preparing for Omicron early on. This bought us time, which we're using to our advantage. Israel will once again be pioneering the global vaccination effort. Omicron is not Delta. It's a different ballgame altogether. We must keep our eye on the ball, act swiftly and decisively if we want to continue engaging and working with an open country as much as possible throughout this pandemic.
Israel was the fastest country to roll out initial vaccinations a year ago and became one of the first to launch a booster program after observing that immunity waned over time. Its policies on boosters are being closely watched by other nations. They're also considering when to offer additional doses. Sinovac's two-dose COVID-19 vaccine followed by Pfizer's booster shot shows a lower immune response against the Omicron variant compared with other strains. That's according to a study by researchers from Yale University, the Dominican Republic's Ministry of Health, and other institutions. One of the authors of the study says Sinovac recipients may need two additional booster doses to achieve protective levels against Omicron. Sinovac's COVID vaccine is among the most commonly used jabs in the Philippines. In other news, two people still missing following a wildfire in Colorado are feared dead. Authorities said the two missing people were last seen in their homes that were consumed by the blaze. Search teams are now working through the wreckage to find any remains. The wildfire tore through two towns in Boulder County, destroying nearly 1,000 homes. Authorities are still determining the cause of the wildfire. A fire hit South Africa's Parliament building in Cape Town, causing extensive damage. Details in this report.
A fire broke out at the South African Parliament in Cape Town on Sunday, causing extensive damage to the complex. Firefighters tackled the blaze for several hours. By mid-morning, the smoke had started to subside. The disaster came a day after late Archbishop Desmond Tutu's state funeral at St. George's Cathedral, a stone's throw away from where the fire happened. President Cyril Ramaphosa said the work of the parliament would carry on.
Yesterday was a day crowned with celebration, a day crowned with sending off our beloved Archbishop, and to wake up to the devastating news of the burning down of the National Assembly or Parliament is just really a terrible setback to what we were basking in yesterday. Arch would have been devastated as well.
He also said he believed one person was being questioned in relation to the fire. No injuries have been reported, according to a government minister. The cause of the blaze was not immediately known. The parliamentary complex, some of which dates back to 1884, consists of a cluster of buildings. According to Jean-Pierre Smith, a Cape Town mayoral committee member, the roof of the old building had collapsed and the fire had gutted the third floor of the building.
Which is of concern.
He added that the parliament's fire alarm only rang when firefighters were already on site.
A man in his 50s has been arrested in connection with that blaze. The committee investigating the deadly January 6th attack on the U.S. Capitol is weighing whether it can subpoena Republican members of Congress. We have this report.
A U.S. congressional probe of the deadly January 6th Capitol riot a year ago is now looking into issuing subpoenas to sitting Republican lawmakers. Democratic Representative Benny Thompson, who chairs the special committee, on Sunday told NBC News that his panel was examining whether it could lawfully subpoena current members of Congress. Quote, I think there are some questions of whether we have the authority to do it, Thompson said, according to an interview transcript. We're looking at it. If the authorities are there, there'll be no reluctance on our part. The panel is investigating the day thousands of supporters of former President Donald Trump, egged on by false claims of election fraud, attacked police, vandalized the Capitol, and sent lawmakers and then-Vice President Mike Pence running for their lives. The committee also wants to know what happened inside the White House and is seeking communications between Trump allies in Congress and the former president's staff. Multiple people close to Trump, including conservative media TV hosts, urged him during the riot to make a televised speech telling his supporters to stop the attack. Trump waited hours before releasing a pre-recorded message. The special committee last month sent a letter to Representative Jim Jordan, a Republican and ardent Trump ally, asking for testimony about his telephone conversations with Trump on the day of the riot. Jordan said in a recent Fox News interview that he had, quote, real concerns about the committee's credibility, but was reviewing its letter to him. The committee sent a similar letter to Republican Representative Scott Perry. Perry declined to cooperate, posting on Twitter that the committee, quote, is illegitimate and not duly constituted. An appeals court ruled earlier in 2021 that the committee was legitimate and entitled to see White House records Trump had tried to shield from public view.
We're going to take a break now. Still ahead, local alcohol and tobacco products slapped with higher taxes. More on that when you come back. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Other business news, another year, another hike in sin taxes. The excise tax slapped on cigarettes has gone up to 55 pesos per pack this 2022 from 50 pesos per pack last year. The taxes on heated tobacco products also increased to 30 pesos this year from 27 pesos and 50 centavos in 2021. For alcohol products, taxes on distilled spirits are now at 52 pesos per liter and 39 pesos per liter for beer products. The excise on wines has been increasing by 6% annually from the base of 50 pesos per liter in 2020. The increase in excise tax rates is in accordance with Republic Act No. 114-67, which was signed by President Rodrigo Duterte in January last year to discourage people from smoking and drinking and to fund the country's universal health care program. A big-time oil price hike also greeting motorists on the first week of the new year. Gasoline and kerosene prices will go up by a peso and 85 centavos per liter, while diesel prices will increase by 2 pesos and 40 centavos per liter. The hike follows a tightening of supply in the world oil market, as well as a weakening peso against the U.S. dollar. In sports, Jaylen Brown's career night lifted. The Boston Celtics passed the Orlando Magic 116-111 in overtime. Brown torched the Magic for a career-high 50 points. He scored 21 in the fourth quarter, where he personally rallied the Celtics from a 14-point deficit. Boston improved to 18-19 on the season. The Philippines' first Olympic gold medalist not yet done making history for the country. In an Instagram post, weightlifter Heidelin Diaz bared her intent to try and qualify for a fifth Olympic Games. Diaz posted a photo of herself holding a miniature Eiffel Tower and adding the hashtag Paris2024. For more on this story, head on over to news.abs-cbn.com. And as we start the new year, Manny the Movie Guy reveals his favorite films of 2021. Take a look.
Ten. The Lost Daughter, Maggie Gyllenhaal's directorial debut, boasts a strong performance from Olivia Colman. She's an unreliable narrator waiting for redemption.
Nine.
Mass. This criminally underseen gem tackles gun violence without finger pointing, but aims to be a unifying force. One of the best ensembles of the year.
Eight.
Dune. Director Denis Villeneuve surprised everyone by successfully adapting an unadaptable book and creating an entertaining and thought-provoking homage to the source material.
Seven.
Licorice Pizza. Paul Thomas Anderson gives us a coming-of-age film that is at once nostalgic and dynamic.
Six.
Don't Look Up. This is so funny, it's scary. One of the most polarizing films of the year forces viewers to confront their own fears. Adam McKay makes his own Dr. Strangelove, and watch for Leonardo DiCaprio's speech near the end that rivals Network's Peter Finch.
Five.
Drive My Car. Art and life collide in this brilliant study of grief and loneliness. Rich and honest, it's my favorite international film this year.
Four.
Coda. The title means child of deaf adults, but the film does not pander to people with disabilities. Get ready to laugh, cry, and clap at this masterpiece where everyone's represented.
Three.
West Side Story. I love the 1961 classic, but Steven Spielberg succeeds in making me forget the original and embrace his vision of an updated Romeo and Juliet story with racism and gentrification as backdrops.
Two.
Belfast. Kenneth Branagh writes and directs a semi-biographical film that is about his love for cinema, family, and country. Smartly shows the troubles of Belfast in Northern Ireland through the eyes of a little boy.
One.
The Power of the Dog. All hail Jane Campion for giving us an absorbing film that unfolds like a true great American novel, anchored by great performances. It's a movie that will stick with you for years to come. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ANC, looking forward to another great year at the movies. Happy New Year!
And that'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. Play back this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe.
Keep it here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.